got someone very special that's here to share with you today. Would you give a warm Journey Church welcome to Pastor Donald Schatz?
Love you, Rob. Well, Happy New Year, everybody. How are y'all doing this morning? All right, man, y'all seem to be as lively as that 9:30 crowd. I love it. Hey, I want to thank you all that have been praying for me over the last few weeks. And for those of you who don't know, I had to have another cervical fusion in my neck. And so if you see me walking around like a toy soldier, that would be why. Okay, so I got a little ways to go, but man, I appreciate all the prayer. But man, is it ever great to be able and just to get out and do stuff. I mean, like drive. I mean, just driving is just awesome all of a sudden. You know, we take things for granted so easily, but you know, man, when you're laid up in a recliner for 4 weeks just, you know, watching reruns of America's Funniest Videos, it gets old. You know, I didn't even realize how many episodes comes on in one day of that thing, you know, but if you're like me, you love the segment in America's Funniest Videos that, you know, where they do the slow-mo where people falling, stumbling, and falling in slow motion. Anybody ever seen that? That's hilarious, man. I don't care who you are, you know? It just is. I love it, you know? And it's funny when you start to think about it, you know, that process of stumbling and falling. And then when you see it in slow motion, it's just hilarious. And the thing about it is those people are getting messed up, and I'm not so sure why it's so funny, because you know that some of those people ended up in the hospital in traction, you know, but for some reason when you slow it down, it's just so funny. And I think it's that attempt to recover from the stumble that makes it so funny when you see it in slow-mo. And when you stop and think about it, that whole process of trying to recover from the stumble is what's so funny. Have you guys ever thought about that? No? Well, it's okay, because I have for the last 4 weeks. I really, it's just where my mind goes when I get really bored. I can't help it. But there's this process with stumbling that starts with like the unexpected. You know, you're just walking around, you know, you're not expecting it. But first there is the stumble, and then it seamlessly transitions into your very best attempt to try and not hit the ground. And, you know, hopefully you're able to recover from it and go on your way unaffected. And, you know, except for maybe your pride. Isn't it funny when you stumble? You know, you kind of look around, make sure nobody saw it. And even if they did, you kind of play it off, make like you meant to do it. Well, my point this morning is life is a lot like that. Life is full of stumbles, falls, and recoveries. And since this is the last day of 2017, I just felt the need to encourage us all as we begin to enter into this new year and talk about what we usually wonder most about. And the question we usually think is, what's going to happen in 2018? Is it going to be a good year for me, or will it be a bad year for me personally? And I'm no prophet and I don't have a crystal ball, but I do think I know the answer. After all, I've had 4 weeks to think about it, right? So here's the answer to that. Next year, actually, in some respects, is going to be a lot like this year. In some ways, it's going to be just business as usual, and you're going to have some victories, and you're going to have some defeats, and some of your dreams and your hopes are going to come true, while others are going to take a nosedive straight into a hard reality called, it ain't going to happen. Is some of your plans are actually going to come to completion, while a lot of them, they're going to go undone, like some of those honey-do lists that you still haven't done. And some days you're going to feel like the steamroller. Some days you're going to feel like the pavement that the steamroller flattened out. You're just going like, what's going on, Lord? But in many respects, life is going to be the same next year as it was this year. And we're going to all face those same ongoing challenges in our walk with the Lord. But know this, church. Know this. Your steps in the coming year are ordered by the Lord. Amen? See, He's in control of everything in your life. He's in control of all the uncertainties. He's in control of all the stumbles, the falls, and even the recoveries. And I want more than anything this morning for you all to see this truth in Scripture today. So if you have your Bibles, turn to Psalms 37. We're going to look at verses 23 and 24 today. Very, very powerful Scripture here. It says, "The steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord, and he delights in his way. Though he fall, he shall not be utterly cast down, for the Lord upholds him with his hand." Would you pray with me this morning? Lord, we come to you, Father God, and we thank you for your word, God. Would you help us, Father, in 2018 to trust in you, to trust in your word, Lord, no matter what we face, God. Would you help us to praise you in the good times and in the bad times, Lord? God, most of all, Father, I pray in 2018 would be a breakthrough year spiritually for everyone that is in this place today, God. So, Lord, would you bless the reading of your word? Would you help us to hold it in our heart, God? And more importantly than that, God, would you help us to live it out and apply it? In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Well, as I've been sitting around for the last few weeks trying to make some sense of my life really over the past decade, I couldn't think of a better verse to wrap my mind around and for us to wrap our minds around as we approach the coming year. And the reason why is, you know, we typically don't question when the good things are happening in our life, do we? I mean, good things like new jobs or maybe job promotions or job raises. Woohoo, come on with that, right? Or maybe good health reports from the doctor. I'm waiting to hear one of those. But we don't. We don't typically, you know, make too big deal or wonder why. Well, Lord, why are you blessing me? We don't think that. No, we just say as believers, we just say things like, praise God. Thank you, Lord. And man, we're just grateful that something great is happening in our life. And the reason why is we just typically don't question that. For example, you know, just again, like good things that happen in your life, man, we're just very, very appreciative of that. So in our text today, we're even real quick to claim that promise. You know, for the Lord upholds us with our hand. And we love that stuff. But I want you to know, first of all, the promise that's found in our text today, it's unconditional, but it's only for the believer. It's not just for any man. And it's important to know that because actually it does say the good steps of a good man, or some translations say a righteous man, are ordered by the Lord. And I think it's really good to point this out because the word good was never even in the original Hebrew, ancient Hebrew text that this was written in. The word good does not appear in there. If the translators who translated from ancient Hebrew over to the English had not been very careful, it would have just read, "For a man's steps are ordered by the Lord." That would have led the reader to believe that, well, it's for the believer and the non-believer, or just for anybody. But the Hebrew word that's used here, the word man, is not your typical Hebrew word for man. It's a different word for man. It's the word gaber. Gaber. This is what it means. It means strong man. It means warrior. It means a man of integrity. It means the type of man that will stand up for things, that has a very strong emphasis on strength or the ability to fight for that which is righteous. It's not only referring to the kind of man that will stand up and fight for the things that are righteous, externally speaking, but it's also for the type of man that will fight within himself against the temptations and the struggles to avoid them, okay? So a little lesson learned here, the translators inserted the word good, the adjective good there, to carry over the proper meaning into the English language. And the reason why it's so important to understand this is, again, because it would have led people to believe, well, just this is just for anybody, right? It could have been, people would have thought, this is just for somebody, well, if I just attend church every now and then, I could apply this to my life, but that's not true. It's only for the believer. It's only for the one who follows the Lord Jesus Christ. So the English word good provides proper emphasis on what type of man the Lord actually delights in. Now, I'm pointing this out to you guys because these are some really comforting facts to wrap our minds around as we begin to dissect this verse and, more importantly, apply it to our life and walk in it. Why? Well, because whether the believer walks through good times or even bad times, the Lord delights in it. Man, that just messed some of you up. Yeah, look at all your faces. Wait, Donald, you mean to tell me that God actually delights when I have to walk through some hard stuff, well, not so much that God delights when you're hurting. Now, I don't really mean that, but the question should be that, does God ultimately delight when he orders us our steps to walk, that lead to walking into some hard times? And the answer to that question is absolutely. You probably think, well, wait a second, man, that's just messed up. You know, that just kind of rubbed the cat the wrong way in our thinking, doesn't it? Well, let's look at the passage a little bit closer. Let's go back to it. It says the steps of a good man or righteous man are ordered by the Lord, and he delights in his way. See, I want you to notice in this verse there that the he refers to God. His refers to us. And the verb ordered there, it's a super strong word. It's a very strong word in the ancient Hebrew language. In other words, God not only directs our steps, they're not only predetermined, they're not only ordained, they're actually ordered by God. This includes our going out and our coming in. It includes our walking about. It includes every area of our life, our walking, our driving, our sleeping, or whatever. It includes every aspect of our life. Because he is God, because he's omniscient, in other words, he's all-knowing, there are no accidents with God. There's no, oops, my bad, didn't mean that to go wrong. There's none of that with God. So whether we're lying down or whether we're getting up or whatever we're doing, you know, God is in control of every facet of our life, whether it's good or whether it's bad. Even if that ordered purpose means that we're going to have to walk through some really hard times. And you know, one particular word that stands out in our text today that sheds some light on this fact is the word though. Look at it right there at the very beginning of verse 24. It says, though he fall. Notice it does not say if he falls. You say, the word if would declare a probability, while the word though actually declares a certainty. It's absolutely or certain. It doesn't say if he falls. It says though he falls. Some translations say when he falls. But the word though gives proof to the fact that God ultimately delights when the believer has to walk through some really hard times, because there's a big difference between the word though and if, right? And so we're going to have that just the way it is. And we're just going to have to walk through some things. And so there's a certainty that is being stressed in this verse. And I want to point that out to you today. We're all going to stumble, guys. We're all going to fall sometimes. It may lead to a fall. It's not a matter of if. It's just a matter of when. And I don't know of any passage that better illustrates this in the Word of God than the story of Job. You guys remember the story of Job? Let's consider it. Look at Job 1, 8 through 11. And I love this passage, by the way, because I just love it when God taunts Satan. He's messing with Satan here. Check it out. Look what he says. He says, the Lord said to Satan, and here's the taunt. Have you considered my servant Job? There's none like him on the earth. He's a blameless and upright man, one who fears God and shuns evil. It's ticking Satan off. Satan answers him and says, does Job fear God for nothing? Have you not made a hedge around him? In other words, a hedge of protection around his household and all that he has on every side. You have blessed the work of his hands and his possessions and have increased in the land. But now stretch out your hand and touch all that he has, and he will surely curse you to your face. So God agrees to Satan's terms, and we don't have time to go through the whole story, but God agrees to Satan's terms, and he says, you can do anything you want to Job, but you just can't touch him. That's the only condition. Look at it, verse 12. And the Lord said to Satan, behold, all that he has is in your power. Only do not lay a hand on his person. And so if you know the story, Job loses everything, right? You know, back in that day, a man's wealth was measured by his possessions, and Job had a lot. He had a lot of land. He had a ton of livestock. And so he was a very wealthy man. He's not a guy who just had a couple of cows out in the pasture and a sheep and a goat, okay? He had a lot. And so Satan destroys everything this man had. He took everything away. He took away his property, his livestock, and he even takes his kids away from him. He takes everything away from Job. So at this point, but still through all that, if you know the story, you know what? Job kept, he stayed faithful to God. He didn't bend a bit. And so at this point, is God one? Is Satan zip at this point? So obviously, God's delighted in this. Even though Job lost everything, even his kids, how can we know that for sure? Because God starts taunting him again. Look at it, Job chapter 2, verse 3. The Lord said to Satan, "Have you considered my servant Job?" I just think that's funny for some reason. "There's none like him on the earth, a blameless and upright man, one who fears God, shuns evil, and still he holds fast to his integrity, although you incited me against him to destroy him without cause." Now, I mean, if that wasn't the ultimate slam dunk in Satan's face, I don't know what would be. And here's a crazy thing, guys. I don't know if you ever thought about this, but Job has no earthly idea this is going on behind the scenes. Job has no idea that there's this dialogue concerning him going on behind the scenes between God and Satan. All he knows is all of his life, man, just things are rocking and rolling. And look at the land I have, the cattle, and look at the family, all the stuff that he's got. And all of a sudden, it's wiped out over nowhere. Man, I just can't imagine what must be going through his mind. But look at Job chapter 2, 4 through 6. So Satan answers the Lord, "Skin for skin." That's probably one of the most wickedest things I've ever read in Scripture. You know what Satan meant by that? What he meant by skin for skin is that, God, you've only allowed me to go what I consider to be skin deep with Job. That's crazy. I mean, he lost everything, even his kids, and Satan determines that to be just skin deep? He goes on to say, "Yet all that a man has, he will give for his life," which is probably the only place in Scripture I know of that Satan's actually telling the truth there. It's true. I mean, you get the news you have a terminal illness, and all of a sudden your material possessions won't mean a whole heck of a lot to you. So that's true. He says in verse 5, "Stretch out your hand now and touch his bone and his flesh, and he will surely curse you to your face." And the Lord said to Satan, "Behold, he is in your hand, but spare his life." And again, we don't have time to go all the way through the story. But Satan causes some really gnarly boils to break out all over Job's body. If you ever had just one of them things, that's enough. But I mean, they break out all the way from the top of his head down to the tip of his toes or all over his body. And the only thing that probably Job had left at this point was his wife. And even she says, "Dude, why don't you just curse God and die? Get it over with, for crying out. Look at you, you lost everything. You're a mess. Your health's a wreck. Just get it over with." Look at Job's response to her in chapter 2, verse 10. But he said to her, "You speak as one of the foolish women speak. Shall we indeed accept good from God?" See, that's what I was saying earlier. We don't question when the good stuff happens. But look what he says. "And shall we not accept adversity?" In all this, Job did not sin with his lips. So is God too? Satan zip. Here's my point. It wasn't so much that God was delighting in the fact that Job was going through this. That wasn't where the delight was. He knew full well that Job would ultimately praise him for it. That's where he began to delight in the trial and saw what Job had went through and saw how he overcome this trial. You know what? Another great example of that is us as parents. Hey, you remember when those of you, your kids are maybe grown now, maybe some of you have some kids that are in this stage, but remember when your kids are really little and they're probably around, maybe not quite 1 year old, and they started crawling around and they started pulling themselves up on the coffee table, you know, and walking around or trying to walk at that point. And then when you see that starting to happen, you grab them and you start trying to walk them along, you know, doing that, and you let go of them. And what happens? Most of the time, what? They fail, right? And so when they fail, did you snatch them up, spank them, and call them a loser? No. You simply picked them up, you know, wiped the tears off their face, and you got them going again, right? You kind of delighted in that. You know, it's funny, every time you see your kids fall and they're trying to walk, we kind of snicker and laugh because we knew ultimately they're going to start walking. You see, it's in the falling that they learn to walk. And whenever they started to walk, what do? We got the camera. It's delightful. See, in our minds, we knew at the very that this was going to take place. We knew that eventually they would get it. Even though they fall and cry sometimes, we'd still delight in that because we knew eventually they're going to get this. They're going to start walking. So why would we struggle at the very thought that God delights in our hard times that lead to maybe some very difficult circumstances that we're going to have to walk through? Listen, he does so that ultimately we're strengthened by it. Ultimately, we're encouraged by it. And at some point down the road, we're going to be able to encourage somebody else that's going to walk through the same stuff that we just had to go through. Amen? You see, David understood this fact. David wrote this psalm. He understood that all men eventually stumble and fall. I think it's really interesting that right after David wrote the 23rd Psalm, "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want," he commits the sin of adultery with Bathsheba. And then he commits murder to cover it up. What about Peter? Remember Peter, Jesus' disciple? Remember he boldly declares that Jesus is the Christ? And then remember when he, in the garden, when they tried to arrest Jesus, he cuts off a dude's ear just because he laid a hand on Jesus? And then Jesus says to Peter, "Peter, you're going to deny me three times before the rooster crows." And Peter's like, "No way, it's just not going to happen." Well, we know how that worked out, right? But whether a stumble is from an immoral sin or whether it's just from some crisis that you're going through or a crisis of belief, the Bible is full of examples of very godly people that had to walk through some really hard times. And hey, these stories, they're in the Word of God to instruct us, to encourage us. They teach us that even the best of men, under the right circumstances, can stumble and, yeah, can fall. Hey, don't ever think you're so strong that you can't. Don't ever think that. And every now and then I hear somebody saying, "Well, I just can't believe that that happened. So I can't believe they did that. I can't believe they committed that." I'm like, take heed. Take heed. So the question usually becomes when we're examining these types of verses, usually becomes, so if God orders our steps, does that mean that our sin is also ordered by the Lord? Well, the short answer to that question is absolutely not. Okay, and I don't have time this morning to unpack such a deep and tough question, but I do want to skim the surface for you. Look at James 1:13. It says, "Let no one say when he is tempted, 'I am tempted by God.' For God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does he himself tempt anyone." Hey, I could stop right there, but let's check out Hebrews 2:18. "For in that he himself has suffered," he being Jesus, "being tempted." Remember, Jesus was tempted after he had fasted for 40 days. Satan comes and tempts him. "He is able to aid those who are tempted." So he doesn't order our steps into sin. I mean, why would he? Why would he send his son to die on a cross and yet order us into sin? That just doesn't make sense to me. And when you consider the fact that Adam and Eve stumbled and definitely fell into sin. And even though, that's just crazy to me, because they had unhindered access to God. They walked with God. They talked with God. They were able to fellowship with God. And even at that, God has one rule, one law. Don't eat the fruit of that tree. But they willfully chose to disobey God's law because they wanted to be like him. They were deceived in that. But my point is, in all of that, you ever thought about this? Did God turn his back on them? Yeah, he cast them out of the garden. I get that. But did he turn his back on them? No. One of the most beautiful things in Scripture, Their nakedness had been revealed to them. In other words, their sinfulness had been revealed to them. See, you know what God did? God, the very first sacrifice that you see in Scripture, in fact, the very first death should have been Adam and Eve, because God said, in the day that you eat of that fruit, you shall surely die. In that moment, they died spiritually. Later on, they died physically. But the first death in Scripture is not Adam and Eve. It's an animal. God takes an animal, and he sacrifices this animal, and he takes the skin, and he covers them. It was a shadow of what was to come one day. That one day, God would not turn his back on man's situation. That one day, he would send the Lamb of God to be sacrificed for the sins of man, for all that would return to him and receive him as Lord and Savior. It was a shadow of what would come one day. And so we always wonder, well, why did God allow that to happen? Why did God allow Adam and Eve to fall into sin? And maybe this side of eternity, we never know the complete answer to that. But I know part of the answer. It's because whenever lost sinners are redeemed, it points to God. It gives glory to God. You see, whenever my wife got saved, I saw a difference in her life, something I knew that I did not have inside of me, and I got saved. God's glory was put on display. Whenever Will got saved, God's glory was put on display. Whenever any of you got saved, that put God's glory on display. Why? Because it was a changed life. You were once walking one way, and you repented and started walking for God in that sense. So my point is that even in our redemption, even in our restored relationship with God, we still sometimes can stumble and make some bad choices. And as we've seen today in Scripture, no one's exempt from this. However, it's what you do in the fall that makes all the difference. Some people, some folks will allow it to consume them. They'll just lay there in it. Some people will just, as something's going on in their life, man, they just can't get past it. And some people say, you know, I could never get out of my sin. I could never get away from my addiction. I could never get away from alcohol. I could never, you fill in the blank. But that's not what God had for us. See, the stumble can result from anything. It doesn't necessarily have to be from an immoral sin. It can be from situations. It can be from something that comes into our lives so subtle. Maybe it's something that's going on in church, and you just don't think it went that way. You just think it should have done something else. And so you got mad and took your toys and went home. Maybe somebody said something that offended you in church, and you just never got past it. And so you left that church. Hey, let me tell you something. The only reason you ever leave a church is if God calls you to do that. If God's calling you to go serve somewhere else. Otherwise, you leave the church because you're mad, that's a dog chasing his tail. Every church you go to, you're going to leave that one too, and you'll continue that process. Because what? Guess what? There ain't no perfect church. There's no perfect people. We all stumble. We all fall. We all do some stupid stuff every now and then. But whether a stumble is from a loss of job or a loss of a loved one, or maybe you're here and you just found yourself just relocated in Jacksonville, and man, you're just trying to make new friends or maybe even find a church home, and that's a struggle. That can even lead to a stumble because you just get so tired because you're just not making that connection. You haven't found that church. All of a sudden you find yourself going to church once a month, and all of a sudden you fall out completely. But whatever the case is, whether it's from an immoral sin or from a crisis in your life, it's never an excuse or a reason to continue to live that way. When God saved you, he saved you to a new life, a new creation. That means being able to walk through pretty much anything with God's help. It's like the illustration of a butterfly that you may have heard before. You know, you take a caterpillar. What does a caterpillar know? I mean, all of his life, there's just leaves and there's bugs and there's dirt. But that's all he knows his whole life is leaves, bugs, and dirt. And then one day he takes a nap. It's a long nap, kind of like the one I'm going to take today when I get out of here. But it's a nap, right? And he wakes up, and you just think what must go through his mind. I mean, he's a butterfly, and he just starts flying around, and he's just going, no way. I mean, just think about what must go through his mind. And yet the Bible says in 2 Corinthians 5:17 that if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things are passed away, and all things become new. And I'm thinking that's the way we're supposed to live, with that kind of confidence in God that he can get us through any situation and any time. One thing for sure, the butterfly doesn't go back to being a caterpillar. The butterfly may stumble. He may fall down to the ground, get his wings a little dirty every now and then. Maybe a hard wind comes down around and knocks him down to the ground, but he gets back up and he does what a butterfly does. Starts feeding on nectar. For us, that nectar is the word of God. That's what we need to be doing. Here's my point, guys. It's what happens in the stumble that makes all the difference. What do I mean by that? Well, let's just summarize the teaching of our text today in two simple points. One, God ordains every step we take. The good times, the bad times. Man, we need to grab a hold of that as we approach 2018. Though you may stumble, though you may fall, God ordains every step that you take, and we need to know and understand that God has got this. Amen? Here's the icing on the cake. This is going to put the new in the new years right here. You guys ready for this? Are you ready for this promise? The second statement, God promises that when we stumble or fall, we will not be utterly destroyed. The Lord has got a hold of you, even if it doesn't seem that way. We should never doubt that, no matter what Satan throws your way in 2018. Let's look at our text one more time today. Let's bring it full circle. Psalms 37, 23 to 24. The steps of a good man, a righteous man, are ordered by the Lord, and he delights in his way. Though he fall, he shall not be utterly cast down, for the Lord upholds him with his hand. I got some points I want to put on the board for you to help you remember these facts. A. Every detail of our life is under God's control, even if it just doesn't seem like it. It's irrelevant. Behind the scenes, just like Job, God is in control. B, God takes pleasures in our struggles to walk in holiness, guys. It shouldn't surprise us. It really shouldn't. Jesus had to walk through some pretty tough stuff. As did Peter, as did Paul, as did many great men in the Bible. It shouldn't surprise us. And see, God designs our trials so they will not destroy us. Though he fall, he shall not be utterly cast down. So now let's sum up the application of this passage today. Number one, here we go. You ready for this? Your struggles are necessary. Fight on. Number two, your Father's not forgotten you. Hang on. Number three, your future is assured. Walk on. So what do we have? We have fight on, hang on, walk on in 2018, guys. I'm going to close with this thought, and I want you to pay really close attention to what I'm getting ready to say to you. I don't want anybody to misunderstand what I'm getting ready to say. In 2018, God will not put you in an unbearable situation. Let me repeat that. God will not put you in an unbearable situation in 2018. However, he may put you in a situation that seems unbearable so that you'll turn to him. That's how God works. That's how he wants to work in our life. Remember, God doesn't give his strength in advance. He gives it when we need it. So what that means is each day when you walk through 2018, you're going to have what you need. God promises that to us. Last verse I want to share with you today, and I close. Romans 8:28. Powerful verse. It says, "And we know, not think, that all, not some, things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are called according to His purpose." I've heard this verse used out of context a lot, and people just, any situation that comes up anywhere, anytime, people will throw that verse out there. It's not for anybody. Same as our text today, it's an unconditional verse for only the child of God. It's only for the good man, the righteous man. It's not for anybody. This is a promise for us that we should hold on to. So let me end this last message on the last day of the year with some quotes by a guy that I read a lot behind. I love this guy. I got a high respect for him. His name's Ray Pritchard. You might want to Google him. And just godly man, writes some awesome blogs and just some godly preaching. Ray Pritchard writes, "If you're tired of your sin, run to the cross. If you want a new start in life, run to the cross. If you feel like a failure for the things that's happened in 2017, then you run to the cross. If you fear your future in 2018, you run, don't walk, to the cross. If you need some hope and encouragement for the things that you are about to face maybe in 2018, you run to the cross. And most of all, my sweet friends, if you need Jesus, you run, don't walk, to the cross." Amen? Would you pray with me? Father, Lord, thank you for your word. Thank you for the truth and the power of your word. God, may we hang on to this passage today, Lord. Would you recall it to our memory, God, when we walk through both good times and bad times, Lord, to help us to praise you in those amazing, awesome blessings that you bring our way, Lord Jesus. But Father, when the trials come, help us to walk through them and with knowing for the fact that you have our hand, you have our best interests at heart, and Lord, that you will see us through it, God. Lord, my prayer is today, Father God, that we would just grow closer to you. I pray in 2018, Father God, that your house would be full. I pray, God, for the people that should be maybe in a small group or just doing something to grow closer to you, God. You would impress that on their heart, Lord, in 2018. I pray for people who have an ability to lead and to teach, God, that you would rise them up to lead a small group in this amazing church, God. I pray for this discipleship and church growth would happen like we've never seen it before, God. But Lord, unless we hold fast to your promises, we won't see any of this. Unless we trust you in these things, we won't see any of this happen, Lord. So we're asking you, God, to do this in our hearts and our lives. And while heads are bowed, eyes are closed. Man, if there's anyone here that maybe 2017, maybe the events of 2017 kind of made you fall away from God, and you just feel the need right now to rededicate your life back to God, would you just simply raise your hand? I won't embarrass you. I just want to pray for you. Would you simply just raise your hand? Anyone at all? Yes, sir, I see your hand. Anyone at all? Yes, I see your hand. Well, maybe you're here this morning, and man, just God has just spoken to your heart, and your heart's been beaten. Hey, that's the Holy Spirit of God. That's the greatest compliment you're ever going to receive. That's God just urging you, tugging at your heart to come to Him and trust Him as Lord and Savior. If you need Jesus this morning, I wonder if you would be so brave to raise your hand this morning. Anyone at all? Thank you, Lord God, for the ones that have chosen to rededicate your life, God. I pray, Father, Lord, as a church family, we would rally around not only them, God, but everybody. Lord, I pray, Father, for discipleship and growth this year, God. Lord, would you help us, Lord? We praise you for this new year, God, and all that you're going to do in it and through it. In Jesus' name. Hey, if you raised your hand, we have some folks up here who would just love to show you your next step. For the rest of you, Happy New Year. I would love to meet you if you're new to Journey Church. I'll be right down here. God bless you.